and opinions expressed in the following show are solely those of the hosts and their guests and not those of W4CY Radio, its employees, or affiliates. We make no recommendations or endorsements for radio show programs, services, or products mentioned on air or on our web. No liability, explicit or implied, shall be extended to W4CY Radio or its employees or affiliates. Any questions or comments should be directed to those show hosts. Thank you for choosing W4CY Radio.
Welcome to Outdoors People, with me, C.W. Getz, and her, Maya Marzaki. Good evening. It's Wednesday, April 19th, 2023. We've got a kind of, It was really chilly this morning, but then it was 69 degrees. I did check this earlier, but we went outside. We had a storm, another storm. Imagine that. But 69 degrees. Yes, but I was saying sunny. That's what I got. I wrote here, but then it turned cloudy and rainy, and so I just think it's overcast right now. So actually, it's cloudy. It is cloudy. That is 21 degrees Celsius, kids. Anywhere other than the United States. What do you got there in São Paulo?
We have the same weather, but the difference it is that we are in the winter time and there is no storms, just a beautiful sunny day.
It rains a lot there in the winter though, right?
On the summer.
Just on the summer, yes.
Now that is winter, like no rain, blue sky, just beautiful, good weather, just perfect.
Well, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if you people get snow one of these days for all the weird weather that's going on in the world. Going to be going, what is this? The world's coming to it. It could happen. You never know.
Well,
in California, had something like that. My family out there told me, they said, yeah, we've never had snow here. I don't know how many years it was, but they were talking about the desert in Mojave. So it's interesting, though. Yeah. I think the weather makes me a little, I think I'm turning into a grumpy old man. I think. You notice that?
I don't think so.
This week has just been kind of not a great week either. So maybe that has something to do with it. Oh my gosh. Well, today's episode of Outdoors People is brought to you by Rutabaga Paddle Sports, providing time on the water.
By Campground Views, making camping easier.
By Duluth Pack, made in the USA since 1882.
And by Jackson Kayak, pursuing joy through paddle sports.
Tonight's episode is where neuroscience meets the outdoors with our special guest, Dr. Lindsay Bira. 37-year-old Dr. Lindsay Bira is a Harvard-trained PhD clinical health psychologist, adjunct medical professor, public speaker, and a PADI freedive instructor who specializes in evidence-based treatment, neuroscience-based solutions, and leadership well-being. In 2022, she founded Ocean Oriented, a neuroscience by ocean resiliency initiative, offering multiple levels of experiences to promote well-being and growth in high-performing professionals. Dr. Bira spent years as a top psychologist treating PTSD and trauma in the military, leading adventure trips for Wounded Warrior Project, and creating scuba diving programs for military veterans. In 2018, Lindsay left her work in the military to bring these tools to the public, focusing on maximizing performance, success, and well-being in physicians, lawyers, and business leaders. Dr. Bira utilizes freediving as a powerful vehicle for mindset growth and connection while folding in the neuroscience of resiliency in effective ways that lead to lasting benefit in a beautiful and raw natural environment that uplifts and also challenges. Lindsay has found her own balance and growth through freediving and spearfishing with her business affiliations and endeavors. Lindsay weaves together her top-tier research background, extensive clinical expertise, and her vibrant style to deliver effective and engaging initiatives that deepen existence, well-being, and performance in all areas of life. And with that, welcome to the show, Lindsay.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah. Glad to have you here. We were asking you, what's your weather? So you can just repeat it for everybody. What is your weather? Tease us a little bit, right?
In Miami, I mean, I think it's around 70. It's been a little bit cooler the past couple of days. Some really nice, crisp air, no humidity. So it's been very nice.
Nice, nice. Yeah, no storms.
No storms.
Just for you, CW.
Yeah, right. I mean, yeah, I just feel like we're living in the weird weather zone. How's that? Oh my gosh. Well, Lindsay, tell us how you as a psychologist and the outdoors actually came together in your practice.
Yeah. So it's, you know, been a very interesting journey. And, you know, before I launched Ocean Oriented, as you had mentioned, I was involved in the Wounded Warrior Project, where I was facilitating and helping out with the educational piece on these expeditions and these adventures that we would lead out at ranches. So it would be with a group of veterans. And so I did multiple of those. And around the same time, I was also consulting as a part of a group to develop a scuba diving program, Operation SCUBA, at one of the local universities for university students who are also veterans, the non-traditional students who were veterans. And so I've known for a long time how important it is. The research shows it's so important to be outdoors and to kind of learn new skills and really refresh ourselves. But specifically, you know, for somebody who has, you know, more anxiety or PTSD, that can be very important. And so I was kind of involved in that. And then over time, it led to development of Ocean Oriented. And what kind of came in was my own experience with freediving and spearfishing that I just kind of fell into and continued to pursue. This was in the beginning of COVID, and saw such power in that I continued to follow it, and then realized that this could be a really cool way to tie it all together. And so I did with Ocean Oriented.
That's amazing. How, you actually, just from your personal experience or experiences, I mean, that must have, you discovered something. Like, man, what is this going to take to implement this sort of thing? I'm thinking that just didn't happen overnight, did it?
You're absolutely right. So it was interesting because when I started spearfishing, I learned about freediving, because people who spearfish, they are very much an advocate around safe diving, right? And so you safe dive through understanding the safety skills of freediving and what your body's capable of and not pushing your limits. So that's how I found freediving. And then when I learned freediving, I realized there was such an overlap with learning freediving and how to freedive well, along with anxiety treatment. So one evidence-based treatment for anxiety and panic is what we call interoceptive exposures, which means you get your client, your patient, to feel uncomfortable on purpose. Oh, and you teach the brain to basically rewire around that discomfort so that the brain no longer labels discomfort as dangerous. And that means anxiety goes down overall and panic attacks stop happening.
Wow.
One of those interoceptive exposures is a breath hold to 60 seconds. So my whole journey as a psychologist, I've been training people to hold their breath to 60 seconds as a way to teach their brain to better manage anxiety. So as I was learning freediving, I thought, wow, there's something really to this, because as soon as I create a new relationship with my alarm bells, mm-hmm. and say, oh, I can feel those alarm bells, but they don't mean anything, I'm able to dive deeper for longer. And it's the same thing with anxiety or something that we fear. If we just decide not to label that as dangerous or bad, then we're more likely to be able to tolerate it and learn new things in that environment, new things about ourselves, et cetera. So I thought this is a really interesting overlap of the skills that it takes for freediving that's actually helping me manage my nervous system and expand literally into new depths. And then also these evidence-based treatments for anxiety. So that kind of got my wheels turning. At that point, I was just geeking out about the concept, right? So I was just saying, oh, this is so cool as a psychologist. And freediving is really kind of the combination of three sciences: physics and how physics activates our biology, our mammalian dive reflex. But the only way to tap into that is to have psychology and to trust in the process.
Wow.
So, you know, what had happened, it was actually interesting. I did all my levels of freediving certification. I said, great, this has been a beautiful journey and happy to use my skills to spearfish. And then I got a sheet in the mail from PADI and it said, congrats, the next step would be to be an instructor, a freedive instructor. And I thought, I would never be a freedive instructor. I'm a psychologist. That would be weird.
Right.
And so I went to bed that night and I actually had a dream about me on a catamaran leading a group of people through resiliency training as both a psychologist and a freedive instructor.
Wow.
And folding the neuroscience of wellbeing and resiliency into experiences of freediving and spearfishing. And I woke up from that and I thought, that actually makes a lot of sense. So I decided to follow it.
I love it. I love it.
Oh, That's so cool. Like, I was so excited for talking to you because I kind of do the same in here with rock climbing, because you can access those processes as well when we are rock climbing, right? So that's so exciting. That's so nice to hear. But what I'm wondering here right now is about your work with military personnel suffering from PTSD and also with wounded warrior.
Yes, so that's been a large part of my career as a psychologist, and my training throughout my path is working with veterans, so people who have already been in the military and have gotten out, so through the VA system, and then also working with active duty military, so people who are still enlisted and who might be returning from combat. And so I started to learn about PTSD and how to treat PTSD in a civilian population. So this was survivors of childhood sexual abuse, survivors of sexual assault, accidents, injury, you know, that whole population in civilians. But then throughout my training, I started to get the experience with the veteran population, and then did my residency in association with veterans, and then did my fellowship with active duty military. And so for years, I was treating people with post-traumatic stress disorder. So for those of you who don't know what PTSD stands for, it is post-traumatic stress disorder. So this means, and anybody can develop it, even though rates are low, because usually our brain kind of sifts through things, but sometimes something can get stuck. But most people experience some type of trauma, usually multiple traumas throughout life, because life's just weird and messy and things happen. But when we experience a trauma, sometimes it gets sticky and our brain doesn't know what to do with it. And so then we have longer term issues with that. And that can be anxiety, depression, or it can be post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. And so there's a lot of really great evidence-based treatments around how to help somebody who's dealing with PTSD or other effects of trauma. And so that's what I'm highly specialized in and what I offer in my private practice.
That's awesome.
Yes, that's very cool. And what brought you back to Florida?
Well, I did my PhD here at University of Miami. So I was here for 5 years and absolutely loved Miami. I think it's such a vibrant city. I'm obviously a huge ocean person, although I didn't know what that meant back then. You know, I just loved being around the ocean and scuba diving a little bit. But I just thrive in Miami. And so when I had been gone, I lived in Boston for a bit and then back to Texas and started my career as a professor down there and started my private practice in San Antonio, Texas. And it was going great, except for I still very much missed Miami deeply. Ah, I felt drawn back. Yes. And so somebody told me once you get the sand in your shoes, it will always call you home. You can never get it out. And that's true. I had sand in all my purses and my shoes for years, even after I left Miami. Oh. So there were a certain kind of set of events that happened that were kind of, you know, kicking me back to Miami, and I finally listened. And so I came back in 2019, and I'm so glad that I did.
Nice. Very nice.
Yes. It is just the perfect place to scuba dive in as well, right? So yeah, it's like paradise for you.
Yes.
So we are going to a little break. Don't go away. We'll be back with more of Outdoors People.
A few years ago, someone asked Rutabaga's owner, Darren Bush, "Hey, how long have you guys been selling boats?" Darren replied, "Well, we don't sell boats. We sell time on the water." Of course, that comes in all types. We help people paddle more safely with Rutabaga outdoor programs. We rent canoes, kayaks, and stand-up paddleboards. We sell and install racks to get you from home to adventure. Rutabaga's got everything you need to get you out on the water, like paddles, life jackets, dry bags, and clothing. Rutabaga Paddle Sports, on the web at rutabaga.com. Mention you saw this ad on The Camping Show.
It is time to go camping. Introducing Campground View's virtual tours. You can tour the campground, see the sights, see if they are available, and click to book your perfect spot. Hit the open road and explore the amazing places found in nature. We make it easy to discover, find, and book your site so that you can go have the fun and freedom you seek. Campground View's virtual tours make it easy and simple for you to see where you are going.
Duluth Pack is handcrafted for every lifestyle, making memories since 1882. In store at 365 Canal Park Drive or online at duluthpack.com.
Big family, a community of paddlers, and we want to make sure that everyone has a great time out on the water.
We are made right here in Sparta, Tennessee, USA.
This is where every Jackson kayak is born, built by hand with a focus on innovation.
We are Jackson Kayak.
We are Jackson Kayak.
And we're back with Dr. Lindsay Bira. Lindsay, tell us about Operation SCUBA and Ocean Oriented. Just give us some details, like what you can expect, what someone would experience when they were there. Just kind of lay the setting out for us.
Yes, definitely. And so Operation SCUBA was something that I did years ago in affiliation with the university, where we set up a program for student veterans so they could engage in scuba diving as a way to find camaraderie after leaving the military at the university setting and work on mindfulness skills. So that was Operation SCUBA years ago. And then Ocean Oriented was what I founded in 2022. And Ocean Oriented is where I fold the neuroscience of resiliency into ocean adventure for high-performing people and leaders at sea. So I lead this at sea. And so usually what it looks like is we do full expeditions to the Bahamas. So this is where there's a charter flight that takes somebody from Fort Lauderdale over to Bimini. And then I'm on a catamaran at sea. And then when people arrive, I have an amazing taxi driver that takes them and kind of dumps them off on this deserted beach. So everybody's standing there with their luggage. And part of this is I don't give them a lot of details, because you can imagine somebody who's leading a business, very high performing, they're very control oriented in positive ways, right?
Yeah.
Part of this experience is flexing and going with the flow, right? And tolerating some stuff that might come up. So they don't really know where they're going. They know they're coming to a boat, but they kind of get dropped off, and then we dinghy over, pick them up, and bring them to the boat. And of course, it's a beautiful catamaran. We have a Michelin star chef involved, and it's all ocean to table. So we catch the fish and we eat what we catch, fresh sashimi, fresh ceviche. It is truly an experience. And then throughout the whole time, I'm folding in modules of resiliency. So we start out with individual growth plans and have meetings before the expedition. And then as people are on the boat, I meet with them one-on-one to integrate in pieces that they are going to benefit from through every single thing that we do. And so as we're learning the free diving and everybody's challenging themselves with the breath hold, I call this like a petri dish or a rapid test to see how you are responding to stress, what your relationship with your own stress response is. And so very quickly, I can see how somebody's able to hold their breath and push themselves and maybe what's getting in their way. And so I'm folding that resiliency science into every single thing that we do.
That's so cool.
I have to ask you, so these business people, and I know how they are, I've spent time around a lot of them, but here's the deal. When they're on the island, I can imagine, and they're waiting, they're like, they don't have many details. I understand how you do that. any of them ever start taking attitude before you even get started?
You know what? No.
Really, and really don't.
I think the reason why is because they're excited. They've selected this, right? And that's what I really learned about branding, is when you really put what you're doing out there and saying, look, here's what I'm offering, then your ideal clients do find you. And so that cuts out a lot of the noise, right? And especially there's a lot of video calls that I do before these trips, because as you can imagine, somebody kind of has to be vetted before they come on a boat, kind of, you know, out at sea. There's important kind of things to kind of watch out for. And so most people know that they're there for an adventure. Most people kind of trust me as a professional, and they're down for the experience. So no, I haven't so far experienced any of that, even in some really interesting situations where we almost got kind of whisked out to sea in this current. One of my female CEOs, she's like 5 foot flat, and she's one of the ones that got whisked out. And so in situations like this, you know, it's been interesting to see some things that happen, but how most times things are manageable and everybody, you know, maintains a good attitude. And the interesting thing that we process afterwards is when unexpected things happen that kind of shake you up, it's actually some really great bonding time. And usually it's the moments where we learn the most.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Yeah. When you connect with people, right? Mm-hmm. Like this moment, that's so impressive how you could combine all those things. That's very, very nice.
Thank you.
And could you tell us more about free diving and how it differs from scuba diving?
Yes. So there is a big difference, and most people don't know that. And most people haven't heard of free diving, so they kind of think it's the same thing. Scuba diving involves all the external equipment. So it's the tanks, it's the regulators and the vest that you have that funnels the air and allows you some buoyancy. And it's the regulator, which kind of fits in your mouth. So you're breathing pressurized air. That allows you to stay down for longer. There's actually more risks involved though. So you have to watch out for nitrogen narcosis from the pressurized air. You have to watch out for the bends. So decompression sickness as you go up, there's a lot of math that you have to calculate and make sure that you're going to be okay, because it's an unnatural way to be underwater. It's fun. Mm-hmm. It's beautiful and allows you to stay down there. But free diving is the natural way to be underwater. So this is where you don't have an external breathing device. You just use one breath of air. So you take your breath at the surface, then use that breath fill to go down. Whoa. And spend time and then come back up. So you have to know your limits, because obviously, you know, we're going to run out of oxygen at some point. But what's very beautiful about free diving is that our bodies, every single human has built within them the mammalian dive reflex, which is a biological response to the physics of the ocean. So our body actually responds in ways that allows us to be efficient underwater. So what happens is when we have temperature receptors kind of around our eyes and underneath our nose, that as soon as our temperature receptors feel cold, it starts to trigger the mammalian dive reflex. We also have pressure sensors around our lungs. So as soon as we go down about 10 feet and our lungs sense that they're being compressed a little bit, even though we're not breathing, then those receptors send a signal to our brain, and this triggers the mammalian dive reflex. What happens, our heart rate slows significantly, our blood pressure slows significantly, our blood actually gets shunted, so it's vasoconstriction, our arteries and vessels constrict and push our blood more to our core, so we actually have more blood in our brain than we ever have at the surface, so this allows us to have more oxygen in our brain and be more efficient underwater, right? People don't realize that. So they say, I can never hold my breath underwater. But when the dive reflex kicks in, you have more oxygen than you even realize. We also are able to hold our breath a lot longer than we think, because we've got a lot of oxygen in our bloodstream. That panicky feeling is just in response to the buildup of CO2, but oxygen stays high. It takes a long time before oxygen starts to drop. So you learn a new relationship to that CO2 feeling, and you know that it just doesn't mean anything. You've got a lot of time before your oxygen drops. So there's a lot of things that happen. Our spleen also holds some very rich oxygenated blood cells that we don't ever really need, but it just holds all this rich oxygen blood. And so what happens when you're free diving, the mammalian dive reflex, at some point, it actually squeezes all that out. So your blood actually has more oxygenated blood cells than you ever have ever. Wow. And so you get to kind of this meditative, extremely calm state under the water and realize, wow, my body is actually capable of so much. Wow. Trust it and trust in the science.
That's amazing.
How crazy is that? Oh my gosh, you can like learn about yourself like physically and mentally. That's just amazing. I'm freaking out here. I want to try right now.
That's super interesting. I mean, all that stuff. I mean, I've had some experiences. I had a bad experience a few years ago in some whitewater, and it didn't feel like you just described, but it was a whole different situation. I wasn't purposefully trying to do that. There's a little panic that sets in but
definitely.
I like.
And that's a different situation, because you weren't expecting it and couldn't prepare. Right. So part of free diving is you get, so you do your breathe up. So basically you breathe in for about 4 seconds, hold it, and then you get real comfy and breathe out really slow. So this is before you even go underwater, because what you're doing is you're getting your mind prepared, but you're also getting your heart rate as low as possible, because then that means you're burning less oxygen, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I would have the same experience as you. If I got dumped in the water and it's whitewashed water, because your adrenaline is going, you're pumping a lot of blood, so you do burn through oxygen. So I hear what you're saying.
Okay, good. See, I was thinking it was just me, but that's normal. Okay, good. I do feel better knowing that. I've got an interesting question to ask you. People use the term forest therapy or forest bathing with regard to spending time in nature as being therapeutic. And you mentioned that earlier. What's the science of that, Lindsay?
We actually have a very strong body of science around how important nature is for our well-being, even on an immediate chemical level. So if we think about what we're trying to fight against as humans, is we're fighting against what every long-term illness kind of boils down to, and like the things that get us in the end. Cardiovascular disease is the number one killer of humans. 1 in 4 men and 1 in 4 women will die of cardiovascular disease. But that's not just something that happens later on in isolation. It's actually a buildup of things for many decades. And one thing that we look at that really lies behind a lot of health issues that we end up having is chronic inflammation. And so chronic inflammation is our body's response to chronic stress, essentially. So this involves cortisol, it involves other inflammatory markers. And essentially that inflammation affects our arteries and our vessels, the wall of that, in a way that plaque will stick more, and it causes other issues in our body. And so if we look at the benefits of nature, science shows very strongly that just a brief time in nature actually reduces our cortisol levels. And cortisol is what marks chronic stress and lays the stage for chronic inflammation. And if we think about why this is, we can really think evolutionarily. If we are in a nature environment, this means that we have resources and we can be calm and relaxed. They show that if a nature environment has more vibrancy and more aspects of nature, then we have an even greater response of dropping cortisol, right? So let's say we are in, you know, a park with some trees. That's beneficial. But what we're going to see more of a chemical good response to is a park with some trees, a stream, and singing birds.
The whole
that
deal.
That would have a big physical effect.
Yeah, the big package of outdoors.
Yes.
So cool.
Yeah, so people, go outdoors. Be outdoors. It is good for your health.
Absolutely.
In general.
Absolutely.
No questions about. So we have some pictures and videos to look up after this little break. So don't go away. We'll be back with more of Outdoors People.
A few years ago, someone asked Rutabaga's owner, Darren Bush, "Hey, how long have you guys been selling boats?" Darren replied, "Well, we don't sell boats. We sell time on the water." Of course, that comes in all types. We help people paddle more safely with Rutabaga outdoor programs. We rent canoes, kayaks, and stand-up paddleboards. We sell and install racks to get you from home to adventure. Rutabaga's got everything you need to get you out on the water, like paddles, life jackets, dry bags, and clothing. Rutabaga Paddle Sports, on the web at rutabaga.com. Mention you saw this ad on The Camping Show.
It is time to go camping. Introducing Campground View's virtual tours. You can tour the campground, see the sights, see if they are available, and click to book your perfect spot. Hit the open road and explore the amazing places found in nature. We make it easy to discover, find, and book your site so that you can go have the fun and freedom you seek. Campground View's virtual tours make it easy and simple for you to see where you are going.
Duluth Pack is handcrafted for every lifestyle, making memories since 1882. In store at 365 Canal Park Drive or online at duluthpack.com.
We're one big family, a community of paddlers, and we want to make sure that everyone has a great time out on the water.
We are made right here in Sparta, Tennessee, USA.
This is where every Jackson kayak is born, built by hand with a focus on innovation.
We are Jackson Kayak.
We are
Jackson Kayak.
We're Jackson Kayak.
We are
Jackson Kayak.
All right, we're back with Dr. Lindsay Bira. One, we've got some photos, and I believe we have some videos as well that Lindsay sent us. And let's take a look at those. We'll start with the photos. How's that? Lindsay, you can tell us what we're looking at.
Great. Oh, yep. So that was a spearfishing mission that I did here in Miami. And I was coming up from the deep, and my photographer friend got that shot.
Well, that's a great picture.
How beautiful.
Yeah.
Elsie Glore on Instagram. Oh, yep. This was just recently in the Bahamas. Maybe was it a month ago or so? And this was, of course, I got a conch, which aren't too hard to get. Sometimes you have to go deep for them, though. And then I also got a white margate. So I shot that on a pole spear with my headhunter pole spear. Oh, wow. And we ate very good that night.
Wow.
Oh, and this is a workshop that I led at one hotel here in South Beach, which is a top hotel. It's absolutely beautiful. And this workshop was on the neuroscience, the neurobiology of music and mindfulness. So we had two musicians in the back there who would play certain noises, and everybody experientially would watch what their brain did and how they responded to certain types of music. And then I described the neurobiology and how our brain benefits from the right type of music.
How cool.
It was cool. That's my claim to fame lobster right there. Yes. So
When I looked at that, I said, I wonder how much that thing would cost. In a restaurant.
I know.
It's huge.
It was huge. And that picture almost, there's another picture that's even bigger. It looks even bigger. But yes, you know, that was a huge lobster that I speared in the Bahamas. So in Miami, you do not spear lobsters. In the Bahamas, you can.
Oh, wow.
So that was a big daddy that was underneath basically a lobster house. Just kind of by itself, and we lifted it up, and there he was, and got him.
That's cool.
Love it. It was good eating. We even ate the legs. If a lobster is big enough, you can eat the legs like crab. Very good.
Oh, wow. Really? I didn't
know
that.
This is two other kinds of fish. Actually, that's another white margate on the right there. And then the other one is a Nassau grouper. And so, of course, you know, you have to have grouper season. I think season starts again May 1st is grouper season. But wow, good eating meat.
Wow.
And this is a free diving training session that I'm doing. So this is where we're doing the line diving. And so there's a plate and a weight at the bottom of that line. So the plate is so that you can see how deep it is, and the weight just keeps everything tight. And so we kind of duck dive and we go down, and then I'm getting this person to basically learn how to equalize and how to go down the line with certain techniques. And I'm watching to make sure that they're okay and doing everything correctly.
That's I'm going to ask you, how deep do you go when you free dive? Like, what is kind of typical?
The max for all the certifications is about 110 feet. For the first level certification, you only go 33 feet. So it's 10 meters or 33 feet.
Wow. Yes. That's rude.
Wow. Yeah. 100. That's a lot.
This is the edge of a blue hole. So the world's second largest blue hole exists in the Bahamas. It's on an island called Long Island, and it's called Dean's Blue Hole, and it's absolutely beautiful. In fact, once a year, the worldwide competition for freediving happens in this blue hole, Dean's Blue Hole, and it's just, you know, amazing how deep people go. This hole drops, so that right there is about 45 feet where I'm sitting on that ledge. It drops down to about 650 after that.
Whoa.
I know. And so you can see what's so cool about this photo is that there's actually sand waterfalls.
Yeah.
How the sand is making a waterfall. And when you're underwater, it actually looks like a waterfall. But of course, you're in water and it's sand.
Amazing. There's an incredible amount of light there. I mean, is that just natural, or is nobody lighting up that? There's no one lighting.
No, it's because the water is so clear. It is crystal clear in the Bahamas. You know, the Bahamas have been called by astronauts the most beautiful place in the world because of the clarity of the water and the blue. Yeah. And I know multiple people who've traveled and sailed all around the world thinking they were going to find, you know, amazing places outside the Bahamas. And they've said that the Bahamas are their favorite place just because it brings so much.
Yeah. I went to the Bahamas, but I didn't do what you're doing there. That's for sure. But it is, yeah, it is beautiful. Wow.
This was in the Bahamas again on a shipwreck that's half outside of the water and half inside because it's relatively shallow. And it's called the SS Sipona. So this actually grounded, the ship grounded, I think it was like in the 1940s. And then after that, the military used it for target practice from planes. So there's a lot of holes, but the ship is really unique because they built it out of rebarb and concrete. So it's just very interestingly built. So you can actually get on top of it and then you can swim inside of it. So my photographer, underwater photographer friend, Elsie Glore on Instagram, got this great shot.
That's very amazing. Cool.
Yeah, that's so amazing.
This is one of my favorites.
I like this one. I saw it. I go, yes, we're
just hanging out.
Yeah, just casually. Yes, this was about almost 60 feet down on a wreck on the bottom of the ocean floor. And what's so cool about this wreck, you can see those two nurse sharks, one in the back and the tail had just passed me of the other one. And these nurse sharks just circle and circle around. And there's some other animals and other sharks that kind of, you know, hang out there. But again, Elsie Glore, epic underwater photographer. We both dove down. I perched and he got this shot.
Wow. I didn't even notice that shark until you just said that.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the boat. I mean, you know, yeah.
Right.
You know, I have a dream of swimming with sharks. So I hope I can make it soon. Yes. You are giving me more like need of doing as soon as possible.
Well, and here's what I love about this as a psychologist is most people in the entire world think that sharks, if they are in the water with a shark, that they are dead. And it is the furthest thing from true. If you look at the aerial footage here of Miami Beach of all the swimmers, you also see sharks all around, but people have no idea. And it's because the sharks don't care about people. And this is something that I've really learned as I've swam with 3-ton tiger sharks in the Bahamas, is that when you are in their environment, they see you as another basically apex predator, and they know that they don't like humans. So you can swim with them. You can interact with them. You have to be careful and kind of watch for certain signs of shark behavior to kind of understand what state they're in. And of course, we don't want chum to be all in the water. And there can be a level of danger if you've just speared a fish because the shark will try to get the fish. And it could accidentally get a piece of you, right? But when we look at when shark attacks happen, it's usually because somebody is thrashing on the surface of the water, not knowing what they're doing. So they're mimicking a fish, or they're standing in the middle of what we call a bait ball, which is like a lot of little fish kind of swirling around, and sharks zoom through bait balls to get a snack. So if a human is standing in the middle of it, a shark could bite a leg, but then it lets go and runs away and says, ew, what was that? So if we really look at the data on shark attacks, you know, most times they just don't care about humans. And so I love to crack those beliefs. And this is what we do on Ocean Oriented. Some people would never get in the water with sharks, right? And so as they start to learn about it, the science, the statistics, and then they have the experiences where their brain learns, I was just in the water with a shark and I was fine. We get some really epic photos like this.
Wow.
That's just amazing. That's crazy. Yeah.
This is my friend Freediver Steph. She's another great one to follow on Instagram at Freediver Steph. She has 7 world records in spearfishing, and she's been my ocean guru. So that's where I got with her all of my freediving certifications. I've spent so much time on her catamaran. She quit her corporate job and bought herself a catamaran, has been living out in the Bahamas. She's now sailing to French Polynesia, but this is her dinghy and these are her 2 dogs. So she and I were on a spearfishing mission, just diving down and getting fish, and our photographer shot that shot.
How cute.
So this is another freediving training sesh. So we went down and this person, one of my guests on Ocean Oriented, he was able to touch the plate. And so as we were ascending, I'm keeping my eyes on him to make sure I'm not seeing any signs of distress or blackout. And so that's my sign of, are you okay? And you sign back, I'm okay. And he was actually doing a fantastic job, not fighting for the surface, but allowing himself to feel and tolerate the distress and do that slow ascent.
That's so impressive. That's so cool.
Thank you. this is one of the first steps in freediving training. So this is what we call a static apnea. And so we practice this outside of the water first, but then this is the peak apnea breath hold training session. So this is where you put your face into the water, and we actually do some of that in the beginning to try to start to trigger the mammalian dive reflex. And then you take that breathe up, and then that one breath of air, and you put your face in, and I time. Most people who do this for the first time, they cross 2 minutes, and many people get up to 3.5 or even 4. Usually the men who do it, because they have greater lung capacity, can get up to even 5 minutes of breath hold.
Wow. That's a long time.
I'm going to tell you something. This is the photo that prompted me to ask you to come on the show.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. When I saw it, I go, okay, this is pretty interesting stuff. We gotta get here right here.
Oh, I'm so glad to know that.
Yes. I'll tell you what, we've got a couple, 3 videos here. Let's take a look at those.
Most people around the world are practicing things every day to master them. To be successful, you have to decide that your passion and purpose are greater than your fear of being judged, that growing pains are a normal part of a higher journey, and that there's always beauty found in the small moments when you're pushing yourself. Keep going.
Are you having any fun? What you getting out of living? Who cares for what you've got if you're not having any fun?
And that's it, right?
Okay. Yeah.
I love that. That's so cool. Those are wonderful videos. And I have to tell you, the last one there with the perfect music for that video. I love it.
Yes, I like that song. Yeah.
I just love it. The first one. I'm just in love with your job. And now I'm even more. That's so cool. That's so impressive.
Thank
Congratulations
you.
For all you have done. That's very nice. And CW, can you book a trip for there and learn how to freedive in?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll get right on that, man.
Let's do it, guys.
Right after the show. I got to tell you something. Cool. Lindsay, you had a picture, and we didn't use that, but it looked like a grand piano. Someone was playing the grand piano. Do you remember which one I'm talking about?
Underwater. Was it that?
Yeah,
video?
Underwater.
Because there was a video right now that we just saw where I was at that piano.
Okay, so I looked away for a second. Is that that's in that video? Okay.
Yes, that's in that video. And that is an underwater statue of a piano and a mermaid kind of leaning on the piano bench. Yeah. And it's really beautiful. It's not even that deep. I think it's like 12 to 15 feet deep. Oh. And just a really cool spot to get some nice footage.
And that's in the Bahamas.
That's in the Bahamas, yes.
That's so cool. See, when I was there, I missed that.
right off of the Exumas.
Oh, wow. Wow. So cool.
Yes, that's very impressive. I love it how you can combine like all your knowledge with psychologist and outdoors in like the best way.
Thank you.
That's very impressive. So where can people go to follow you on social media and also get in touch with you?
Yes, so that would be my Instagram. So I try to stay pretty active on my Instagram and post things that can be very helpful for people. So my main Instagram is at Dr. Lindsay Bira. And then, of course, I have my Ocean Oriented Instagram as well. And that's at Ocean Oriented if you want to see more of that. But feel free to follow me. And I have a link in my bio if anybody wants to create a one-on-one 30-minute consultation, just an educational consultation where you can kind of pick my brain as a psychologist and kind of understand more about any topic. So I encourage you to reach out and follow away.
You know, Lindsay, I've done that actually. And you promptly replied with an answer. And I was like, that's so cool. It's actually, yeah. I mean, and it really is cool. I love what you're doing. That whole idea is amazing.
Absolutely. Yes.
Well, Lindsay, you want to Yes, absolutely impressive. Well, Lindsay, I want to thank you for being our guest here on Outdoors People. It was a pleasure having you here with us.
Thank you so much for having me and shining light on different ways to be outdoors. I think that it is so important to have that time, and especially for women to, you know, learn how to be outdoors or find the right area that really, you know, pulls them forward, and then right instructor. I think, you know, women teaching women is very powerful, and that's how I got into this. So thank you so much for creating this space.
Awesome. Thank you for doing all those jobs and help you us women and people in general out. That's very impressive. And I for sure will talk to you about that later. So thank you for being here. And we'd also like to thank each of our sponsors for bringing you tonight's show. Rutabaga Paddle Sports, Campground Views, Duluth Pack, and Jackson Kayak.
Be sure to tune in for next week's episode, Mountaineering in Bosnia, with our special guest, Ada Starcevic. Until then, for Maya Marzaki, this is CW Getz saying thanks for tuning in to Outdoors People. See you next week.
Ciao.